Hi, today I have Isla from Minnesota with us. Isla, why don't you tell us about your project?
Thank you. So my project was called Goals for Girls, and it addressed the problem that girls in underdeveloped countries don't get the same opportunities we do to play sports. So I came up with a three-day soccer camp for girls ages 12 to 20 in Nicaragua. And then on the fourth day, we had a camp for kindergarten age kids. And then in the afternoon, we split into teams and we scrimmaged. And the hope was always that the girls in Nicaragua would have something to come home to after a long day, and something that can help like spark a leadership role, whether it be on the field or off the field.
That's amazing. So what sparked your idea in making the connection with soccer in Nicaragua for your gold project?
Yeah, so I've been playing soccer since I was three. So it's always been a passion of mine. So for my silver award, I did a uniform drive. So I collected uniforms for my club and I sent them around the world. So like to Haiti and Laos. So I wanted to continue on the project, but make it bigger. So at the beginning, it was just going to be like bringing a group of my friends and I bringing uniforms down, just playing them. But then we learned that they don't actually know how to play, which is surprising because as a Central American country, you just like assume they already know how, but they didn't. So that's like what started the beginning of the project. We wanted to give the girls in Nicaragua the same opportunities that we have.
All right. One of the things that I was amazed about with your project is how many partners you had for your project. So let's talk about a couple of your partners. One of your partners was Project Minnesota Leon. And my understanding is that's how you got your connection to Nicaragua. Is that correct? And tell me about that partnership.
Yeah. So I learned about Project Minnesota Leon through Betty, who's my Girl Scout leader. And she's also one of my friend's grandma. But yeah, so I learned about the group through her, and she had gone down with them before. So we had a connection through them, and they were the ones who helped us connect with the girls. They helped connect our host families with us and how our transportation and food and everything while we were down there.
That's awesome. And then I know that you took members of your soccer team. Your soccer team is Tonka United. How did you decide who was going to go? How did you invite the girls? How did they decide who was going to go? How did all of that work?
It was late August, beginning of September-ish. And I just started texting a bunch of people. I just explained to them what the project was going to be. And then I just waited to hear back. We had a lot of people interested, but not all that could go. So it ended up being me with five of my really good friends.
And then you also were able to get a grant through the Bancroft Foundation. Mm-hmm. Tell us about what the process was to get that grant and what that grant did to help your project.
Yeah, so I received a grant from the Anne Bancroft Foundation. I filled out an application about what my position in like a leadership position would be in the project. And I think they wanted to see how, as a young girl, how we can still change something. And it doesn't have to be always be someone that's older than us doing everything for us. So I filled out an application. I wrote everything that, you know, what my project was going to be. And then Betty, my Girl Scout leader, also wrote a recommendation. And in the end, I got a grant from them.
And that leads me to my next question. So this was a big trip. There were six of you plus your adults. How many adults? Two? One or two?
So there were four adults, six girls, and then my brother went.
All right. And so, you know, that's a big group. And so outside of the project itself, just the travel logistics, there are troops that are always interested in travel logistics. So how did all of those work, and what other fundraising did you have to do in order to be able to make that trip?
Yeah, so I got a lot of help from my mom who helped me with a lot of that. And then we had a travel agency help us as well, make it a bit easier. And then, so with the gold award, you're allowed to do fundraise, but they don't count towards your hours. So we did like 20 plus hours of fundraising. We had a car wash in October at Cub Foods. Then we bagged groceries 3 days at Cub Foods. And then we wrapped presents at Barnes & Noble too. So a lot of hours went into it, but you're with your friends while you're doing it, so it was fine.
Before you went down, I understand that you met with some of the girls that you were going to see in Nicaragua via Skype, right? So tell us how you made that actual connection and what you guys did on your Skype calls to help plan for a good outcome in your trip.
Yeah, so I don't speak Spanish. I took one semester. So we had someone from Project Minnesota Leon, Elizabeth, who was down there with the girls while we Skyped them. We Skyped them twice. And we just kind of, you know, we got to know each other a little bit. Not all the girls were able to make it every single time. So we met two different groups of girls while we were Skyping. And we just, I don't know, we kind of talked about what they wanted to do, why they wanted to do it, and just I don't know. It was just like, I don't know. It was just like getting to know them really before we went. So it's like, well, when we got there, we felt like we already had a connection.
All right. So on those Skype calls, what are some of the things that surprised you that came up that helped make that connection with the girls?
I mean, our connection between like sports, I guess, like mm-hmm. they don't have the same opportunities that we do, but they want them. So the fact that we were able to give them the opportunity, I think it just like connected us because there was something that we had in common that we all loved and wanted to do.
And how did you go about collecting the donations of the equipment and the shirts and all of that? And then how did you get it all down to Nicaragua?
With the equipment, I got a monetary donation from the Deal Foundation, and they helped us with the soccer goals and some cones and some pennies. So that really helped us with money issues. And then... Oh, yeah. And then the Sanneh Foundation, they were the ones that donated a uniform and a box, I guess you could, that's what they call it. So it was a jersey, shorts, socks. And then they also donated soccer balls to us. And then for cleats, I had a cleat drive at Tonka United. So we just sent out an email and a box to put at the dome, just asking for some cleats and like bigger sizes for the girls. To get the uniforms from Sanneh, we actually went and we helped them one day before. So we helped sort all of their donations that they had received. And that's kind of how I had met one of them through one of the people that worked at Sanneh through one of my soccer things. And they mentioned, oh, we have this day if you want to come help us. And then maybe we can donate some uniforms to you. So we went that one day, and that's kind of how we made the connection and asked for the donations for this project. And to get the goals and everything down, I mean, we were on an airplane. We were able to, you know, put it on the airplane.
Okay. So you just planned it along with everything else that you had to take when you went down.
We had, I think we had a lot of luggage allowance between the 11 of us. And I think we had maybe 12 suitcases just for equipment, and then including a couple for like clothes and stuff.
So we talked about the Anne Bancroft Foundation, but you've mentioned a couple of other businesses that were able to help give you funding in one way or another. How did you go about finding those organizations and asking them for those?
So the Anne Bancroft Foundation, I actually heard about through one of my Gold Award advisors who worked with them. And she recommended me to, you know, fill out the application and go for it. And then Betty told me about the Deal Foundation, and she helped me get that grant as well. Oh, yeah. And I mean, I guess I wrote the letters. I wrote emails to a lot of different organizations who were able to help us with everything else.
And did you know about some of these organizations because of support that they give Tonka United in general?
I had actually never heard of any of them.
Okay.
So the Sanneh Foundation is run by a former professional soccer player. So it was really interesting to be able to connect with something that he's been able to do and connect it to something around the world.
So this is where networking with other people and making sure that people know about what your project is and getting the word out there can be really helpful in support financially your project, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that's a great point to share. So then the actual trip. So what was it like to go down to Nicaragua? What was it like to put on those soccer camps?
I don't know what I was really expecting. I mean, it definitely was not what we were used to. The field we were playing on, we were bused to so that we had a nicer field. It was grass. It was dirt and grass. It wasn't what we were used to. However, it was something that the girls that we were coaching were also not used to. So they usually play on an old dried up peanut farm. So having the opportunity to play on something with grass was really big for them. So during the 3 days, we split up into small groups. So there were six of us girls, and we made three small groups. So we were able to connect with the girls on a more personal level. And we were able to coach them, you know, more intimately and just like kind of show them the ropes. And even though there was only one of us who was fluent in Spanish, the rest of us didn't know that much Spanish, soccer is kind of a universal language where you can kind of just like show how to do it and you just understand.
And I understand that when you were in Nicaragua, that you stayed with host families. What was that experience like?
Yeah, it was actually really fun. So there were two of us in a house, and I don't know, it was really interesting. The way that they live is completely different to the way we do. Like it's really simple lifestyle. And I mean, we ate a lot of the same food. We had a lot of rice and beans, but connecting with, you know, our host mother it was a whole new experience. So it was really cool.
Would you go back to Nicaragua?
100%.
Has it given you any interest in possibly taking Spanish once you go on to school?
I've taken a semester of Spanish. So I finished Spanish 1 before we left. I finished, yeah. about a week before we left. So I had a little bit of knowledge, but I want to learn it again. I'm fluent in Chinese, so knowing a third language would be great.
Wow. All right. Fluent in Chinese. That's a skill. So what is your biggest takeaway from your project? What was the thing that surprised you the most?
I guess not really how hard they work, but how like into it they get. So while we were there, it's not really on the topic of soccer, but the community of San Carlos, the village that we were in, was working on a project to bring clean water to their village. And this involved a lot of physical labor, digging trenches. So there was one girl, Griselda, who was able to help the families who weren't able to do their part. And she'd only get paid $7 a day for the work that she did. So it's like such a small amount that we could never imagine, like, you know, having to do so much work to earn. So, I mean, even though she had to work every day, she missed those days of work so that she could come play soccer. And she actually was a really good soccer player. So I guess having something to do to release the stress, that was a really cool thing that we were able to see. Because, I mean, I guess it connects back to, like, with us. Because, like, you know, we're stressed out with school all the time. So having soccer to go to after school, or I guess after work in her case, and after school, it was just a wonderful thing.
That's a great story. And so what did you learn during your project that you wish you had known before you started your project?
I guess knowing how fortunate we are to live where we live and have the opportunities that we get, it's just kind of put in your mind when you're there, because you see how, like, what they have to go through on a day-to-day basis. Like, even having enough money to get on the bus to go into town is a struggle for some of them. So knowing that we're able to do what we do, and we just do it without thinking, it's something big that we don't think about, and we need to.
Is there anything else about your project that maybe I haven't asked that's interesting, an interesting story or something unique that you'd like to make sure that people know about?
It's a lot of work, but putting in the work is worth it. I just got my actual award at a ceremony yesterday, and it was amazing to see the outcome that 80 plus hours of work can do, and just sharing it with everyone is just amazing. And the fact that the project is going to live on.
Right.
With them, they're practicing every Saturday, and they also wanted to, because, you know, on the fourth day we had a camp for the kindergarten age kids that were there, and they had fun watching us put it on for them, that they decided that they wanted to do that once a month for them. So being able to share it with others, yeah, that's pretty cool.
So do you mean the older girls in Nicaragua are now sharing it with the kindergartners? Oh my goodness, that is amazing.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, that just warms my heart. What else has Girl Scouts done for you, just in general, even outside of your gold award?
I mean, I guess the leadership part of Girl Scouts, my troop is pretty small, so we get to decide what we want to do most of the time. It kind of gave me the opportunity to open up my eyes to see, like, we're, even though we're quite young still, we can do what we want to do.
And then, what is your favorite s'mores trick?
I like my marshmallows burnt. And as irritating as it may seem to keep a scorched marshmallow inside the fire, you have to keep it in so that the inside is melted too and not just the outside.
Okay, so thank you for joining me, and I hope everybody enjoyed this interview with Isla. Make sure to subscribe to us on YouTube or Spotify or Apple Podcasts, and make sure to power your passion and conquer your challenges.